I chose this just as a, it's very different from all the previous things that we've done, and it's also not something that we apply very much at Strand. But the core algorithm that I'm going to talk about is actually used all over the place. I'm sure all of you would have used things which use this algorithm without realizing it. But we don't directly use it very much at Strand, but I chose it because it has this very interesting thing about, we're used to doing all our algorithms on, you know, we are comfortable with the number line, now we can go to negative numbers, even though negative itself is a leap of, it's not something that we see in our daily lives, but we are used to it. So positive numbers, rational numbers, real numbers, all of that we are comfortable with, but why would we ever need complex numbers in running an algorithm? So I hope to bring that fact out in the process of describing this. So what is the problem? So the problem is you're given two polynomials. It's a little abstract, but I'll give you a real application where you'll need this. So the polynomials are just given by the coefficients. So you're given an to a0, that's one polynomial. And bn to b0, that's another polynomial. The x is just a variable. So you're given the a's and the b's. So they define two polynomials, and you have to multiply them. So multiplying them means what? You get a new polynomial when you multiply. So you have to take an and multiply with bn. That will give you the coefficient of x to the power of 2n. And then you multiply an with bn minus 1. And then to that you add bn into an minus 1. That will be the coefficient of x to the power of 2n minus 1. And so on. So when you do all of these multiplications, you'll see that you'll need n square time. You have to take every a and multiply it with every b, pretty much. So it's n into n square. And the result, if you want to find the coefficient of x to the power k, what does it look like? So if I want the coefficient of x to the power k, I can choose, I take the x to the power k item from here, and then I can multiply it with the x to the power 0 item from here. Or I can take the x to the k minus 1th item from here and multiply it with the x to the 1 item from here. Or I can take the k minus 2 from here and multiply with the 2 from here. So that's what I've written down here essentially. So you could take, so summing over all I, so you could say I is 0, let's say, so then bk, so that's the x to the power k from the second polynomial, gets multiplied with this guy here. So x to the power k into x to the power 0 is still x to the power k. Then k minus 1 gets multiplied with a1. So x to the power k minus 1 into x to the power 1, that is still xk. So you notice what's happening. So you're sort of starting at a particular point x to the k here, and going to the left, going to the right here, and then you're starting at 0 here and going to the left here. You take this guy, multiply it with this. Then you go one step to the right, one step to the left, multiply, and so on. So that's essentially this formula. This is also called it's called convolution. I don't know if you, I'm sure you would have heard this term or run into it in your engineering days. So the question is now, can one do better? So this is n square time because there are n plus 1 possible k's that you have to compute for. Each one requires a summation that can run over n potentially. So can one do better is the question. So before I talk about the algorithm, let's look at an application. So it's a very strange application. You wouldn't imagine that you would need polynomial multiplication to solve this, but in some strict way, this is the only way we know how to solve this problem. So suppose this is the standard pattern matching problem. You're given a pattern, just a string, and you want to find all its occurrences in the text, which we do every day. Of course, we do it more heuristically, but let's say the pattern was quite long and the text was also very long. But in addition, the pattern has these don't care symbols in it. So the pattern is a string of symbols. let's say zeros and ones for simplicity, you could have any alphabet, but so zeros and ones, but in addition there are don't cares. So those characters can match anything in the text. The text itself is just zeros and ones. So you want to search for all occurrences of the pattern in the text. But the don't cares are allowed to match both zeros or ones in the text. But a zero in the pattern should match a zero in the text. One in the pattern should match a one in the text. A don't care in the pattern can match anything in the text. Without the don't cares, of course, there are a lot of standard textbook algorithms, Knuth, Morrison, Pratt, and so on, that will solve this in linear time. But with the don't cares, it becomes somehow difficult. Of course, you can do it in P into T time. You can see, you can place the pattern at every location in the text. At every one of those locations, you can go and check for every character in the pattern whether it matches the text and so on. So there are mod T possible locations. At each one, you can do a mod P time check to see if the pattern matches the text. So that is easy. Can you do faster is the question. And strangely enough, the only way to known to do faster in a strict theoretical sense is to use polynomial multiplication. There's no other way that it's known. So how do you convert this problem to a polynomial multiplication problem? So we have given these two strings of zeros and ones and the pattern of don't cares also. And we're going to treat them as polynomials. So what does that mean? So if your text was 0, 1, 0, 1, then that's the polynomial. What we're doing is everywhere where there is a 0 in the text, you treat it as a 1. So here there's a 0, so you treat it as, so if this is 0, then you put a 1 here, and then x to the power 0, then this is a 1, so you make a 0 instead, and x to the power 1. This is a 0, so you put a 1 instead, and x to the power 2, and so on. So you treat it like a polynomial. It's like you've been given the coefficients of a polynomial. It's just a string, but treat the first character as the coefficient of x to the power 0, second as coefficient of x to the power 1. Except you flip the bits, make zeros, ones, ones, zeros. So in the pattern, what do you do? Similar, except you don't flip the bits. So if there's a 0 here, you put a 0 here. You don't put a 1 here. So. And now what happens to a don't care? So the don't care is there, so it still stays a 0. So replace, so don't care become 0s. Okay. I mean, we're just creating a polynomial, so we can create whatever we want, as long as eventually the multiplication of these two polynomials will give us all the matches of the pattern. So for the pattern we put, so this 0 translates to this 0. In a text, this 0 translates to this 1. Don't cares become 0s. So now suppose we were to multiply these two polynomials, P reverse and T. So what is P reverse? Before you do this process, just flip this around. So this string will actually become 1D, 1, 0. And then you make exactly the process that I mentioned here. You create a polynomial using that. So this reverse is a little tricky. So the goal is to now show that somehow from this, you can get enough information, or at least half the information that you need to find all matches of the pattern in the text. So let's see why. When I multiply these two, what do I get in the result? So in the result, I get several coefficients, one for each power of x. So the coefficient of x to the k was this. We wrote this down in the last slide. Coefficient of x to the power k is, you have to take, the x to the power kth item from here and the x to the 0 item from here and multiply them, then x to the power k minus 1 and x to the power 1 and so on. So if you were to write down the coefficient, it'll be the k minus ith item in the text, ith item in the reverse of the pattern, those two get multiplied, and then that gets added up over all i. You see, everybody sees this instead of... nothing much has happened so far. Then just for simplicity, this is P reverse, so let me write it in terms of P. It's, so when I say P reverse, this is the ith item in the pattern, in the reverse of the pattern. So in the pattern itself will be the mod P minus ith item. I'm just going from the other side. So nothing much. So for simplicity, I'll even not write this mod P. I'll use my negative numbers to index. So P minus 1 means the end of the pattern. P minus 1 minus 2. So if you look at this picture now, that should be clearer. So the coefficient of x to the power k is obtained by taking tk, the kth item in the text. Remember, we have complemented. Okay, so let's see here. So we've complemented the text. Remember, every zero has become a one. So keep that in mind. So take the complemented tk, multiply it with p minus zero. So take the pattern and place it with its end on the kth item in the text. So place it so that its end is on tk. So we're looking at the coefficient of x to the power k. So to compute that, take the pattern and place it so its end, the last character is aligned with the kth character in the text, so tk. Now you take bitwise, you know, just pointwise multiplication, multiply this with this, this with this, this with this, and so on. That's exactly what is happening here. So take this character in the text, multiply with this character in the pattern. This in the text, multiply with this in the pattern. This multiply with this, this multiply with this one, and then add up the result. That's exactly what the coefficient of x to the power k is. This is the only caveat that I've complemented the text. In the way I formed the polynomial, I've sort of complemented the text. Now what do we have? We have the pattern where zeros and ones are preserved as it is, don't cares have become zeros. We have the text which we've complemented. And we are placing the pattern at every location in the text. If I place it ending at the kth location, I get the coefficient of x to the k as part of that multiplication. And the coefficient of x to the k is simply place the pattern at the kth location, multiply this with this, this with this, this with this, and so on, and add it all up. Now from this, what information do you get? So if I had a way to multiply these two polynomials, then the coefficient of x to the k would be this computation. And I would eventually get this number out. That multiplication procedure will give me this coefficient. So in other words, I have some way of computing, you know, this dot product, so to say. I have some way of computing that, and I have that number with me. From what does that number tell me about, does the pattern match the text here or not? So in particular, think of when will this coefficient be non-zero? So what does it mean to say that coefficient is non-zero?
It's equal to the number of zeros in P.
So any zero in P, when multiplied with a zero out here, will zero out, won't contribute anything. So zeros will not contribute anything regardless of what they are multiplied with on the other side. So 1 here multiplied with a 1 will contribute something. 1 multiplied with 0 will not contribute anything. So the coefficient is going to be just the number of 1s here that are aligned with 1s there. So don't cares don't play a role at all in this, which is a nice thing. Don't cares are not contributing to this. So whenever there's a 1 here aligned with a 1 there, then I'll get a non-zero. So what does a 1 here aligned with a 1 there mean? It means a mismatch because I complemented the text. It means a 1 in the pattern is aligned with a 0 in the text. Which means that I've now, a non-zero means a mismatch basically. The pattern doesn't match at that location. It doesn't match at that location because there's a 1 here and a 0 there. So I'm able to, through the polynomial multiplication process and by looking at these coefficients that result, I'm able to eliminate all the places where there is a 1 in the pattern aligned with a 0 in the text. Now, how would I complete this? How would I eliminate? What else do I need to eliminate? So a mismatch, a pattern will not match the text because either a 1 in the pattern matches a 0 in the text or a 0 in the pattern matches a 1 in the text. How do I eliminate that? Yeah, just flip the bits and run this whole procedure again. Zeros and ones get reversed. So just run the whole thing again. and so you'll do two polynomial multiplications, and you'll be able to eliminate all the locations where the pattern doesn't match. So whatever remains is places where the pattern matches, and the don't cares, as you can see, don't play any role. They don't contribute to a non-zero in any of these coefficients. Get a coefficient that's greater than or equal to 1 if and only if a 1 in t aligns with a 0 in t when t is placed with its end at tk. So this complicated convolution formula, what it's really saying is you take the pattern, you slide it across the text. Every time you place it with its end at tk, the dot product, this dot product, you know, you multiply it and then add it up, that dot product gives you the coefficient of x to the power k. So polynomial multiplication is really you're sliding one polynomial over the other, placing it at every single location, taking corresponding products and adding that up, and that's your coefficient of tk. And therefore now you see the connection to pattern matching is very obvious. You're sliding the pattern at every location, you're taking the bitwise product and adding it up. So therefore you should be able to engineer this pattern matching problem and polynomial problems sort of related, you can see that. And so now you have to run it twice. You have to run two polynomial multiplications to find all matches of P and T, or to eliminate all mismatches of P and T. You can flip the bits and run it again. And if you can do polynomial multiplication fast, you can do this problem fast. And this is the fastest, sort of theoretically speaking, the fastest known way to solve this pattern matching with don't care problem, you know, faster than the P into T time that I talked about. There are other applications much more popular than that one, because in typical applications your patterns are very small, so you just run the P into T algorithm, or you push it into the more general regular expression, the grep framework, which takes that much time, P into T, but it has a lot of heuristic optimization, so it, in practice it runs very fast. So that application is never really used in practice, but this one is used heavily in practice. So image processing, all of image processing requires a number of different operations that fall into essentially this paradigm that I talked about, where you have one big image and maybe one smaller thing that's called a mask of some sort. And you have to take the mask and slide it to every location on this big image. And at every place you place it, you have to take those bitwise products, at a, you know, location to location product, and then add up all of those. So you get a new image or a new matrix where at every location, the new coefficient that you get is place the smaller image at that location, take each pixel here, corresponding pixel there, multiply, and then add all that up, and that value is what you put at that location. This is the core thing that happens in most image processing algorithms. So for instance, if you want to blur the image, you'll have a mask like this where all these entries are just ones, so you're averaging over all of those. So you have to take this mask, go sliding it at every single location and average over all of them. And there are all kinds of other edge detection masks and all kinds of things that you do. And you can immediately see why this is related to polynomial multiplication now, right, from based on the previous example. Polynomial multiplication is exactly taking the smaller polynomial, sliding it all over the bigger polynomial at each location, computing those products. So this is exactly that. So you slide this mask all over the bigger one. Once you place it at that one location, you multiply each bit in this mask with the corresponding bit in the image and sum that up, and place it at that the location where the top left corner. And that's your new set of coefficients. So this is widely used all over the place. And the only way to do this fast is if you have fast polynomial multiplication. So that's those are the applications. Now let's look at the algorithm itself. How do we do this faster than, I'm assuming that the two polynomials for this purpose are equal in size. If the polynomials are highly unequal, it's easy to break up the bigger one into smaller pieces so that you then get two polynomials that are roughly equal in size. So largely the problem, we'll focus on just two polynomials that are both have n coefficients each. Okay, so, and we want to do better than n squared time, because n squared is very slow in practice. So an equivalent way to multiply two polynomials is that you evaluate each polynomial at n plus 1 distinct x is. So for instance, if the polynomial is x squared plus 5, then you could put x equal to 1, x equal to 2, x equal to 3, x equal to 5. And so you'll compute 1 squared plus 5, 2 squared plus 5, 4 squared plus 5, and so on. So you can evaluate each polynomial at n plus 1 distinct x's. And notice that this fingerprint is unique. So if you have a polynomial and you evaluate it at n plus 1 distinct places, and you take that vector of n plus 1 distinct values, that vector uniquely characterizes the polynomial. So for instance, if you have a polynomial x plus 3, how many places should I calculate this polynomial so that I get a unique, just remembering the values at those places, I can reconstruct this polynomial back.
Two.
Yes, x plus 5 is just a straight line, so two x's I calculated at, then those two x's uniquely determine that straight line. So likewise, if I have a parabola, I can calculate it at 3 points, and those 3 points uniquely determine the parabola. So in general, if you have a polynomial of degree n, where x to the n is the maximum power, then you evaluate it at n plus 1, any n plus 1 distinct places. And you remember those n plus 1 values, that is sufficient. From that, you can reconstruct this polynomial back. It's a unique representation of that polynomial. Okay. So you take your first polynomial, and you calculate it at, let's say, v naught to vn, some n plus 1 values that you pick. So you put x equal to v naught first and evaluate this whole thing. And that is what I call a of v naught. So if I'm calling this as a function a of x, where a of x is this whole thing, then a of v naught is that I put x equal to v naught and then add, do all the multiplications, v naught to the power of n, v naught to the power of n minus 1, multiply by an and so on, and add all of that up, I get a of v naught. So I do that for v naught, v1, v2, till vn. So I get n plus 1 numbers. These are just a collection of n plus 1 numbers. And they uniquely represent this polynomial. So any other polynomial will give me a different collection of n plus 1 numbers. Some of those numbers might be the same, but the entire stretch will not be the same. All those n plus 1 numbers will not be identical. At least one number will be different. If I take a different polynomial, at least one of those n plus 1 numbers will be different. So likewise, I take the other polynomial b and do the same thing. So I get two sets of n plus 1 numbers each. Now suppose magically I had these numbers with me. So a polynomial can be represented by its coefficients, or it can be represented by its value at n plus 1 different locations. Those are both equivalent representations. So now, if my representation were this, so in other words, I'm given two polynomials in this form. I'm given their evaluation at n plus 1 places each. Then how do I multiply these two polynomials? To get the new the result polynomial should also have the same representation. So its evaluation at v0 to vn is what I need. Then how do I multiply these two polynomials? Yeah, so the product polynomial is ax into bx. What will its value be at v0? A v0 into bv0. I have a v0, I have bv0, I just multiply these two. So a v0 into bv0 is what the product polynomial's evaluation at v0 is. So likewise, v1, v2, and so on. So for the product polynomial, if I were to evaluate it at v0, v1, v2, and vn, it's the same as multiplying these two numbers, multiplying those two numbers, multiplying those two. So then it becomes a trivial problem, right? Linear time, order n time, I just take, if I have that representation, if I have a representation of each polynomial which is evaluated at each of these n plus 1 locations, then I just take pointwise products, and the new vector that I get is the representation of the product polynomial. Is that, everybody convinced of that? That is true. So you have to do a little bit more. You have to calculate it at more locations. So that's right. So I should extend this to, you should calculate each polynomial at 2n locations, and then do that. So this slide needs correction. This should be 2 times n, 2 times n. So, and then you just do individual products. So AB0 into BB0, AB1 into BB1, all the way to A times 2 times, A time, AB 2 times N and BB 2 times N. That will give you a the representation of the product part. So this is simple. This becomes very simple, linear time, nothing to be done. So AX into BX can be represented in that form. So if all our polynomials were represented like this, then we would be in good shape. Product multiplication would have been very simple. And here also you see something that you would have learned a long time ago. Polynomial multiplication, I said, is convolution. And if you represent it in this form, it's simple multiplication. So to multiplying two polynomials, you can either do it the convolution way if it was represented as coefficients, or if it were represented by evaluation at various locations, then it becomes just simple multiplication. So convolution in one domain is simple multiplication in another. Where did you learn this last? Signal processing, the first year signal and systems course or something like that, second year. Now, this is essentially the same phenomenon. Now, what is the problem that we have solved? Of course, this is order n time, but our problem is we are assuming to begin with that the polynomial is given to us like this and not like this. If it were given to us like this, then multiplication is a trivial problem. So we still have a problem at hand, but our problem at hand now simplifies to taking this polynomial and converting it to this form. Once we have converted it to this form, then the multiplication problem is trivial. So then my problem is down to given a polynomial, evaluate it at some n places. So actually I'll have to do it at 2n, but modulo factor of 2, it is the same. So everybody convinced that now if I can do this, then I can multiply two polynomials. If I can do this step first, then after that everything that I need to do is trivial.
What about getting back the coefficients from the vector?
Right, so same process applies. So this process, the inverse of this,
how costly is that?
It will be the same time as doing this. So I won't talk about it, but it's exactly the same time as doing this. Process is fully invertible, whatever we're going to do. Just nicely inverts, run it backwards, it will give you. So this is what we need to focus on. And somewhere in there, we'll realize that unless we use complex numbers, things become challenging. Before that, okay, yeah, no, this is okay. So how do you evaluate a polynomial? So the polynomial is given as anx and an minus 1x and minus 1. And if you have to evaluate it at any one of these locations, let's say at v0, how would we do that? So we'll have to compute v0 to the power of n, multiply it with an, then v0 to the power of n minus 1, multiply it with an minus 1. How much time would that take? How many multiplications and additions are you performing? Yeah, so to compute v0 to the power n, you might need n multiplications. And then you multiply it with an. That's roughly n multiplication. Then v0 to the power of n minus 1, you need n minus 1 multiplication. And then multiplying it with an minus 1. So it looks like it's n plus n minus 1 n minus 2, that's n squared. But you can immediately see that you can probably do it much faster because in the process of computing v0 to the n, you've also computed v0 to the n minus 1. And so you don't need to recompute every time. So that's called Horner's rule. It's a, I'm sure you've run into this. You can write the polynomial out in this factored way, so that you're never computing x to the power of n, v0 to the power of n explicitly. Each time you're computing v0 into an plus vn minus 1, the whole thing into v0 plus an minus 2, whole thing into v0 plus an minus 3. So this, if you write the polynomial in this way, then it comes down to just order n multiplications and additions. Do you see this? because you have x to the n and then x to the n minus 1. You can take x to the n minus 1 common, you'll be left with an x plus an minus 1. And just replay that game at every step. So you'll be left with a sequence of nested a plus bx forms. Each time you get a plus bx, multiply by x, another b comes in, multiply by x. So this just takes order n time. But for one particular v naught, it takes n time. Now I have order n, I have n plus 1 v naughts. So v naught to vn. Each one, if it takes order n time, then I again get quadratic. So this is not good enough yet. Right. Now what is the other problem that you see? What happens to the number sizes out here? You're computing implicitly or explicitly, you're computing x to the power n here. So let's say n, this polynomial has degree 1,000. So what is x to the power 1,000? Can you even compute it? What will be the size of that number? Will it even fit into into a machine word, into many machine words? Even if you chose v naught to be 2, 2 to the power 1,000 will not fit anywhere. So that's the other problem we have, that you get very large numbers. You get numbers that even if you choose v naught to be 2, you get a number which is 2 to the power of n, which means n, at least n bits. That's, if n is like a million, then you start getting huge numbers which you can't multiply very fast. So that tells you two things. One is V0s have to be kept very close to 1. You cannot even go to 2. The V0, V1 to Vn has to be very, very close to 1. It can be 1 plus 1.000001 or something like that. And then if you raise it to the power n, it may still be a decent number. But it still boggles the mind as to how small can you get close to n, close to 1. Yeah, so eventually you have to show that your numbers all fit, the numbers don't become either too large or too small. That has to be shown. But you know that even if you go to 2, it's out of question, so you have to be very close to 1. Same thing, because so all floating point does it allows you to dynamically see, if it's fixed precision, then you can allow 10 digits after the decimal. But floating point allows you to, you may be 10 digits after the decimal or 10 digits before, and floating point allows you to just calibrate, adapt to whichever one. So it may be going way below or way above. Floating point will just allow you to adapt dynamically. But it's the same thing, you want to ensure that you don't go way below, you don't go way above. So these are the challenges we have, and so let's see how to solve them. We'll come to the numbers, the large numbers issue later. In fact, as luck would have it, this will get taken care of for us in the process of solving this. So our goal is now to compute at V1, plug in each of these numbers into A and compute the result, but not take order n time on every step. Somehow we have to use the fact that we can combine these guys, we don't need to compute them, do this computation independently for each of these. Somehow we can take groups of these and do some computation so that we can get more with fewer operations. So the speed up idea is, okay, so even before I get to the speed up idea, it's useful to basically write this, evaluate AX at V0. What is, if I write it in this way, I have one polynomial, I take its remainder with respect to another polynomial. So what is remainder of polynomial? Everybody remembers polynomial division, right? You write down this polynomial, write down the other polynomial, then just as you would divide, you would multiply this with something, put that quotient at the top, write the product at the bottom, subtract, and then all of that, and that same thing. But when I take a remainder of this polynomial with respect to this polynomial, I get a remainder. What property does that remainder have? Yeah, its degree will be smaller than this guy. So if this is degree 1, then the remainder will be degree 0. Degree 0 means just a number, no x is in it. So what will be the remainder if I take the remainder of the polynomial that I'm interested in here? with respect to some x minus b for some b, what is the remainder that I get at? Yeah, so we see that it is actually FV, because A of x is, the way to see that is, here is A of x is x minus b into some quotient plus some remainder. So what is A of v? So this is the standard division, that when I divide with something, then I get a quotient, I get a remainder. So what is A of v? Q of v into v minus v. This goes away because v minus v. You're left with remainder. Now the remainder is just has no x's in it, it's just a value, it's just a number. Then A of v is just that remainder. So this is useful to write it in this way for reasons we'll see. But instead of saying I'm going to compute A of V, I'm going to say I'm going to compute AX modulo X minus V. It's just a restatement, nothing much. But it's useful for reasons we'll see. But just because you can write this doesn't mean you can do it any faster. You run your high school polynomial division algorithm, X now write and put that the standard sequence, and it'll still take order n time. You won't be able to do it any faster. Now the speed up idea comes. Now you can start combining these things. That's what writing it in this form allows you to do. Suppose you have to compute A of x at two different locations, at V0 and at V1. Then I could do this twice. I could say AX mod X minus V0, compute that in order n time using the standard algorithm, and then say AX mod X minus V1. So then I'll have to do two different remainder operations. Each one will take order n time. But now I can replace that by sort of one operation, after which everything becomes very, very easy. So suppose I were to replace it with this operation. I take AX mod this polynomial. I don't know how fast this will be, but let's ignore that for the moment. Suppose I've done this, I found this A prime X, which is AX mod this polynomial. Then how do I compute AX mod X minus V0? So the nice thing about this A prime is that, what is the degree of A prime now? So this degree is 2, right? The x square here. So this guy's degree is just 1. So it's just AX plus B form. That's all it is. So now given A prime, how do I compute AX mod X minus V0? Just this one. How do I compute that?
Substitute V1 for X.
Sorry?
You substitute V1 in that expression.
Yeah, so let's write this again. AX equals some remainder into X minus V0 into X minus V1. Sorry, this is the quotient. And then some remainder. Now, I have to take this whole thing and find its remainder with respect to x minus v naught. Then how would I do that? Well, x minus v naught divides into this because x minus v naught is sitting here. So I just need to find this guy. I just need to do rx mod x minus v naught. If I have to take this whole thing and take its remainder with respect to x minus v naught, this part will give me a remainder of 0 because x minus v naught is sitting here. So I just need to take this and find its remainder with respect to x minus v. Now what is good about this polynomial? Its degree is very small, its degree is just 2. Because after this, this is x squared, so the remainder will have degree x. So this guy's degree is very, very small. So now if I have to do rx mod x minus v0 and rx mod x minus v1, these are constant time operations, this degree 2, so there are only two coefficients here, So both of these can be done constantly. So I'll have potentially so you take, you do this first to obtain a prime x, then you take a prime x mod x minus v naught, that gives you a v naught, and a prime mod x minus v1 gives you a v1. And both of these steps are just constant time steps because a prime x is a very small polynomial. So I've managed to replace, instead of using this method on v0 and v1 independently, I've somehow managed to, and because independently it's ordered in time each time, I've managed to have maybe one expensive step which does it together, this stuff. After that it's just constant time for v0, constant time for v1. It becomes much faster. So this, so two expensive polynomial divisions have been potentially replaced by one. Assuming that this can be done, we have to see how to do this, but assuming this can be done, instead of doing them independently and spending order in time each time, we've got one potentially expensive operation, and after that, very fast order one time operations to do these. So that's sort of the speed up idea, that you could now start combining these guys and do some sort of divide and conquer algorithm. So that is encapsulated in this picture, and you should be able to now follow what's going to go on in this picture. You start with your polynomial that you're given, and let's say you take mod this entire big polynomial, all the v's are sitting here. What would be the result? What would be the remainder? Remember that there are n plus 1 of these v's here. So this guy's degree x to the n plus 1. Well, this guy's degree only n, right? Our starting polynomial at degree n. So this is an even bigger polynomial than this. So the remainder will be what? Just the polynomial itself. Because if I take a linear polynomial, take remainder with respect to quadratic, no, nothing will happen. You'll just get that back. So this is just a place, you know, just for. This t naught x is the same as a, no, nothing interesting is happening in this big remainder. But as a theme, as you go down, what will happen is you take a remainder here. Now in, you have these two children nodes. Here what you do is you take this remainder and you take half of these v's and take remainder with respect to this. And on the other node again, you take the same, this remainder t naught goes out there, and you take the other half of the v's and find the remainder. So you get the theme here, right? So all the v's are right there at the top. In the left child, half the v's are there. In the right child, half the v's are there. And at each node, you're taking the remainder from the previous node and operating on that. Okay. So at this node, you'll take this remainder. And you'll take half of these v's and do hit this remainder with that polynomial. Take the remainder of, so take this polynomial, which is already a remainder. Take that polynomial, bring it here, take half of these v's, and take a remainder of this guy with respect to those. So the theme should be sort of clear to you. You're starting to combine, not look at each of the v's independently, you're combining them, looking at them all together. All of them are at the top. As you go down, they halve nicely. At any node, I take the remainder from the previous node. The previous node remainder was obtained with reference to a collection of v's. I take that remainder and hit it with half the v's now. So the first half of the v's, that gives me one more remainder, the second half of the v's gives me another, and so on. I keep going. So what will happen right at the bottom? So bottom I'll be left with a single v, and then I'll have a of v. And the important thing to realize here is that whatever remainder I get here, I can work with that out here. I don't need to work with the original polynomial for that reason that we saw here, exactly this reason. Once I have found a remainder with respect to this, then when I want to find the remainder with respect to this, I just need to look at this. This is guaranteed to, you know, divide. So at every step, the remainder that I find, it has smaller degree. That's the interesting thing about that remainder. So I can just look at, I just need to use that remainder and half the v's and decrease the degree even further and so on. By the time I get to the leaves, the degrees will all be one. So I'm sure you all got sort of an intuition into this idea, and all we need is to now think about this statement. If I can compute this quantity, so where I have a particular polynomial here, and that polynomial keeps changing as I go, you know, at various nodes in this tree, this polynomial is different. For a particular polynomial here, I'm hitting it with a subset of the V's. So a polynomial which is made out of a subset of the V's. At the top, I have all the V's. As I go through, the number of V's will keep halving and so on. If I can do this in time that's just proportional to the degree of T, then do you see what the total time taken in this will be?
N log.
Why?
It would be like N plus 2 into N by 2 plus 2 power 2 into N by 2 power into 2.
Yeah. So what is the degree of, now let's look at this polynomial. What is the degree out here at this top? That is N.
Right?
Now when I look at this polynomial, what is the degree here? This node, this guy's degree?
N by 2.
I mean still N here right now. I mean, I've taken remainder with respect to a polynomial of degree n plus 1, so this degree stays n. So this guy's degree is n, but after remaindering, what do I get? The degree is? Because there are only n by 2 v's here, so this is roughly n by 2. So what comes down here will be n by 2 degree, and then after I remainder it with respect to a quarter of the v's now, the degree will become n by 4. So the degree here is n, the degree here is n, the degree here is n by 2, n by 4, n by 8, and so on. Right? So the degrees keep reducing, but the number of nodes also increasing. Here I have 2 nodes, 4 nodes, 8 nodes. So at level I, my degree will be down by a power of 2 to the power I. So if the degree was n, then it will become n divided by 2 to the power I. But the number of nodes is 2 to the power I. So when I multiply the 2, the total degree is n. So the total degree at each level stays n, and that adds up over all log n levels. It's a balanced tree, so it will finish off in log n steps. So over all log n levels, it will become n log n. So the overall, we'll go from an n square time simple algorithm to an n log n time algorithm, if only we can do this. If we can, given a polynomial, if we are able to find, take a combination of these v's and take a remainder with respect to that fast. And so nothing surprising, all we've said is, if I had only x minus v1 here, then I can do this remainder in degree of t time, right? Because that's a simple, whatever polynomial I have, if I am dividing it by ax plus b and quantify remainder, and you just use the high school algorithm, you multiply something, you put that here, take difference, something comes here, you pull down something from here and keep going. That is a linear time algorithm, because this degree is just 1. So you'll multiply it by x to the power of n minus 1 or something, and then one term will cancel from here, and so on. So if I had just x minus v1, then this is simple. This tx mod x minus v1 can be done in order degree of t time. That is just the standard algorithm. The challenge now is I have many of these together, and I still want to do potentially many of these. At the top, I have n of these. I have n by 2 of these and so on. So potentially many of these guys. And yet, I don't want to increase the time in doing this remainder. So given a polynomial and many of these v's, how do I find this model, this remainder in time, which is same as the time taken to take this polynomial and take a remainder with respect to any individual guy here? So that's where the key challenge lies.
But if you're dividing by other polynomial, having any polynomial, the number of successive users will be smaller. Right?
That's what we said.
If you're dividing by linear polynomial, you will do n divisions. If you're dividing by quadratic polynomial, you will do n by 2 divisions.
Yes, that's what we said, right? N by 2, n by 4, n by 8, and so on. That's exactly the calculation. So here the degrees are n here the degrees are n by 2. So the work done will be order degree, so it will be n by 2. Here it will be n by 4. Now the thing is, the number of nodes is also exponentially increasing, but the work done at each node is exponentially decreasing. So that balances out and it gives you n at each level, and that's n log n. So how do we do this in time proportional to the degree of t? So that's the problem we are left with. you to compute that quantity Tx mod some collection of V's you're given. How much would the high school algorithm take? I mean, exactly that algorithm if you were to write it down. I mean, you can see that this is the very first thing. What is this? Maybe you have to multiply all of these out to get it in polynomial form. That itself can be a huge amount of time, right? Because there are two terms in each, so there'll be 2 to the power of, you know, if there are k v's, then 2 to the power of k terms that you, when you multiply them out, they'll open up to. And so if there are n such v's, then 2 to the power of n time is being spent. So clearly you cannot do that. You can't even open these things out. You can't multiply them out and write them in the neat polynomial form. So what do you do with these things? So ignore that. So how do we do this? And so this is where the this is the idea. So far, whatever I've told you is simple incremental steps. This is where the idea comes in. Somebody asked, and I don't even know who it is. This is just so much folklore now. Can we choose the V's so that this polynomial has a very simple form? So, as I said, if I were to multiply out the x minus all those terms, then there'll be 2 to the power of k terms when you open them up. That's too complex, and there's a lot of information. Is there a way to choose the V's? Remember, the V's are in our hands. We can evaluate these polynomials at whatever n plus 1 places that we want. The only issue is that if we choose V's that are even as large as 2, then the 2 to the power of n blows out. But I can choose 1.0001, 1.0002, and so on. I can choose whatever points I want. So is there a way for me to choose the V's so that these product polynomials have a very simple form? So all the cross terms cancel out, only the highest power and the lowest power remains. Everything else has a coefficient of 0, so it cancels out. If so, if this were indeed true, then do you see that this thing could be done very fast? So I replaced this whole big thing by a simple x to the k minus v form. Then you see that remainders with respect to x to the k minus v can be done fast. So let's maybe write this high school algorithm down clearly, and then that will. So what does this say? So you have a polynomial here which is an x to the n, an minus 1 x to the n minus 1, and so on. And suppose you are remaindering it with respect to x to the k minus some v. So you'll multiply this by an into x to the n minus k. So when I multiply this and this, what do I get? I get an x to the n, this into this, and then minus b into an x to the n minus k. So x to the n minus k is sitting somewhere out here. So I'll get minus b into an. So there are only 2 terms. When I multiply this with this, there are only 2 terms. One term here, one term out here. Now I subtract. This term will cancel. And this term, you'll get ank minus ban. Now you have this new polynomial. Now you have to kill this guy, so you'll multiply with an minus 1. And again, you'll get 2 terms here. So at every step, you're killing one term, and you're spending time proportional to 2 multiplications or something like that. And so as you go along, you'll kill everything in n steps, and each step you'll be doing about 2 multiplications. So that's the standard thing, and so it will, remaindering with respect to this will work in order time proportional to the degree. So then we get what we want. So what are we left with? So this is now the crux of how do we choose the V's so that we have this behavior. So everybody with me so far? No. We just have to choose the V's so we have this behavior. So let's take a simple example. How do we choose the V's so that this polynomial starts looking like this? Sorry? Yeah, so I'm just taking a simple quadratic case. In general, we have a more complicated case, right? So we in general, we've got to do this for like whether n plus 1 v's and all that. But let's start with 2 v's and see how to do it. And remember the form that we want. This product should simplify so that only the highest power of x and the zeroth power of x remain. Everything else should have a coefficient of 0. Okay. So if I had this, and I want to simplify it so that here I get what powers? X squared, x to the power 1, and x to the power 0. X squared I'm allowing to remain. X to the power 0 I'm allowing to remain. So I have to kill x. What is the coefficient of x in this multiplication? Yeah, so it is v2 plus v1. And I must set that equal to 0. So I must choose v1 and v2 so that one is negative of the other. So that was very simple. So now if I choose v1 and v2 so that one is, let's say, 1 and the other is minus 1, then I've got the property that I have. So now let's take it up one step further. I'm working in powers of 2, so let's go to 4 now. So when we go to 4, we said that now we need, so remember the tree structure. At the top you'll have all of these. At the next step you'll have these two and these two. So these two, since I've chosen one to be minus a, one to be plus a, they satisfy this property. So these two will simplify nicely. They'll come to this form. These two will likewise simplify nicely. So now I have to just figure out what is a relative to b, right? So what I need to, so there is, written this wrongly, this should be x to the power 4. So there's powers of x to the power 4, there's x to the power 4, then x to the power 3 that has to be cancelled out, x to the power 2 has to be cancelled out, x to the power 1 has to be cancelled out, x to the power 0 will give us minus a into minus b into plus b, that's this thing. Okay. So I have to cancel out the powers of x to the 3, x to the 2, x to the 1, all of those have to be cancelled.
But this can boil down to x square minus a square into x square minus b square. And you again make x square as the sum of y substitute and you can boil down to the first step.
Not quite.
B has to be AI.
I get it. So the solution would be b square equal to minus a square.
Correct. So b square, so if you now solve that, you'll see that the powers of x to the power 3 and x to the power 1 somehow automatically those have easily go away. As we saw, this is x square minus a square minus b square. So the powers of x to the 3 and x to the 1 are gone. So x to the 2 powers are left, and you get this. And this is what you have to insist on. But this can't be solved. What do you do? B square equal to minus a square. Now you're stuck because you don't know what to do. And of course, there's no need to be stuck because luckily the mathematicians went far ahead, far ago. So you say, who is afraid of square root of minus 1? So b is square root of minus 1 into a. So we'll choose. So if our n were 4, what would we choose? The four numbers we would choose are to evaluate this polynomial at would be. So firstly, I have to choose two numbers that are negative of each other, another two numbers that are negative of each other, and then those two should be related by this property. So suppose I choose a to be 1, then b will become square root of minus 1, and then I have minus a and minus b. So square root of minus 1 is I, the symbol for square root of minus 1 is I. So I've got a is 1, then minus a is minus 1, so 1 and minus 1, and then b is I, and then minus b is minus I. So these are my four numbers. And I wrote them in this order because there's a pattern to those. This is really, minus I to the 0, this is minus I to the 1, this is minus I to the 2, this is minus I to the 3. If you look at all of these numbers, when raised to the power 4, give you 1. So minus I to the power 4, minus I square is minus 1, minus 1 whole square is 1. What did I do? Yeah. So any one of these numbers, you raise to the power 4, so 1 to the power 4 is 1, minus 1 to the power 4 is 1, I to the power 4 is 1, minus I to the power 4 is also 1. So all of these are all what are called fourth roots of unity. They exist only in the complex world. And if you calculate at these fourth roots of 1, then you get the property that you want. All these complicated expressions simplify out nicely into just, you know, two terms each. And two terms each, you can, you know, keep managing well. Now let's look at what we would do in general. So in general, you have to choose these to be roots of the nth roots of 1. So if you had, I did it for 4, but if you have, you know, n in general, then you have to choose, evaluate at the nth roots of unity. What does nth roots mean? It is this formula that this thing. So it's a complex number. Cos 2 pi k by n. So the kth, for every k from 0 to n minus 1, these things, so you get 0 to n minus 1, so you'll get n different numbers. These are all the various n roots of unity. So you put k equal to 0, what do you get? You'll get just 1, this will become 0, so you'll get 1. So that's that. There was a 1 in our previous list of 4 also, right? So 1 is clearly a nth root, 1 to the power n is 1. If I put k equal to, so k equal to n by 2, then what happens?
Minus 1.
So I get, correct, so I get minus, so this becomes 0 again.
This becomes minus 1.
This becomes pi by 2.
Cos pi. Pi.
Oh, pi. Correct. So this becomes pi. Minus so one. Cos pi is?
Minus 1.
Minus 1. Yeah. So then if I put it to be pi by 4, n by 4. So if I put n by 4, then this becomes pi by 2. So this goes to 0. Well, this now is sine 90 degrees. So this looks like 1. So now you have an I that starts playing a role. So at n by 4, you get I. And so on. So as you generate all these numbers, you'll get some weird complex number. Now, look at what happens to our size problem.